morning, church. It's a beautiful day to worship the Lord together, and I'm so glad that you're with us online today. I'm Pastor Andy, and I just want to welcome you to service today. Pastor Alan's going to continue our message from the series Not of This World, and I just wanted to remind those of you who are local that our Bible Walk, Trunk or Treat is this evening outside in our parking lot. You can meet Bible characters, get candy, have a great time. And for those of you that are worshiping online, give us a like, say hello in the comments, let me know that you're there so I can add you to my prayer list and check on you during the week. And I just look forward to worshiping with you today. Happy Sunday.
Good morning and welcome to church this morning. We are so glad to have everybody here to share and join in worship with us. I thought we would start our worship together by reading of God's word together. If you'd all stand and join me as we read from Isaiah 12. God is our salvation. Trust him and do not be afraid. The Lord is our strength and our defense. He has become our salvation. With joy, you will draw water from the wells of salvation. In that day, you will say, we will give praise to the Lord and proclaim his name. Make known among the nations that he has what he has done. Proclaim that his name is exalted. We sing the Lord, for he has done glorious things. Let this be known to all the world.
Show. Better than you. that deserves our praise and our glory. We come here this morning, we offer up our lives to you, Lord. It's only because of you that we're here today. It's by your Spirit that we are transformed into new creations. We look different because of you. It's only by your Holy Spirit. Would you pour out your Spirit on us today? Remind us that you are the one who transforms us. It's not us. It's all about you. May we continue to worship this morning. In Jesus' name.
Change Jesus, you change Jesus, what we see and what we Holy, holy, holy. Amen. You may be seated. I'd like to invite all of our children to come up and join me up here on the platform for a sermon in the sack. And all of our kids, go ahead and come right now and come join me right up here on the platform. Right up here. Go ahead and come right up here. And you guys can stand right up here. And I've got a couple of questions I want to ask you today. Come on up here, Owen. Wow, isn't this a great-looking group? Praise the Lord. Okay, can all of you see me? Okay, I want to ask you a question. I'm going to ask you a simple little question here. What do you see when you look in this? What do you see? What do you see, Owen? You don't know what you see? Okay. What do you see? What do you see when you look in this?
Your face.
You see my face? Okay. You see you, right? Do you see that? What do you see? You see you, don't you? I mean, it's a mirror. When you look in a mirror, it's a reflection of us. And a mirror shows us what we look like on the outside. It shows us what other people see. But I want you to pretend for just a moment. What if this mirror could also show us what we look like in our heart when Jesus comes in, when we choose to trust and to follow him? What does our heart look like? What does our heart look like when we choose to follow and trust in Jesus? It looks like Jesus. Isn't that amazing? That when we choose to trust him and follow him, that Jesus is in our heart. And when you look inside of us, you begin to see him coming out from the inside out. What an amazing truth. I want you to say this truth with me. God's Holy Spirit wants to shine Jesus through me. Say that with me, would you? God's Holy Spirit wants to shine Jesus through me. What a wonderful truth. We can look in a mirror all the time and see all kinds of stuff, but when we look into our hearts, God wants us to see Jesus. And we can when we choose to trust and follow him. Thank you, boys and girls, for being a part of this. And we have a praise bag right down front. If you'll get it from Miss Denise and Miss Savannah, as you go back down to your seats, pick up a bag and you can enjoy that for the rest of our worship service. God bless you. Let's give them a hand today.
Our God is so holy, and we are so blessed to be able to know and worship him, are we not?
Yes, amen.
We are so happy to have everyone here this morning. And if you are new here or online, we would love to connect with you. We would love to get to know you better. So we have a number we would love for you to just text welcome to, and then we could connect with you and just start building a relationship, start building a community with you. We are continuing on our series this week. I forgot the name. But it's important. It's about how we are separate from our world. God calls us to be separate because we are to be holy in the unholy world. So as we listen to our pastor just preach God's word to us, just remember that this is our mission, that this is our calling from God, and he has blessed us with his strength and his power to be that holy representative in our world. And this is a blessing and a difficulty at times, but it is something that builds and will bring fulfillment in our lives. And so we will just welcome my father to come up here and just preach God's word.
Not of this world. Sometimes when you're not of this world, you forget stuff, and that's okay. What a blessing to be at church on this day. Today is Halloween. Can you believe that? We kind of forget the whole meaning of what Halloween is because we see Spook City and we dress up in costumes and we have candy and all that kind of stuff. But years ago, Halloween is a derivative of the word Hallows Eve. And it's the evening before All Saints Day. And it was a day when the church remembered all of those that had gone before us. You know, we kind of do that. We kind of think it's a world holiday when we have Memorial Day. Or we do Veterans Day, but way before that, there was a day to remember the saints who have gone before us, who have given their life, Peter, Paul, James, John, all of those, but even people in recent years who have showed us the way to Christ. And so the evening before, there would be a celebration, and the world kind of got a hold of that and said, well, let's kind of go with the spirit thing, and it kind of went out of hand, and so I don't know how you feel about Halloween, but there's some fun aspects to it, and then there's some very not fun aspects to it. And we've got to be discerning of what we do and how we honor that day and celebrate that day. But I'm so glad you're here today. Today is Family Sunday, and so we have our kids in service today, and what a blessing. And so you may see a little bit of rustling around. You may hear a little bit of talking that you'll have to focus through. You may just need to be able to say, it's okay, sweetheart. You can just sit back down and everything will be okay. Or you may need to get out and go to the potty. It's kind of like whatever you need to do. But it's okay because we love children. And sometimes it's not convenient. It wasn't convenient when we were little. And I can't imagine all the trouble I made when I was a kid because when I was growing up, we didn't have children's church. Do you remember that? Do you remember that? When we sat in there and we used all of the offering envelopes and made airplanes out of them. And we used up all the pencils and we kind of broke all the lead off of them. People get frustrated the next Sunday. There was all kinds of difficulties and challenges, but what a blessing to have our kids with us. And tonight is Trunk or Treat, and you'll hear a little bit more about that, but you should have received a card, Bible Walk and Trunk or Treat. Pick up one of those. Give it to your neighbors. I know you've got just a few hours, but let other people know about this special time that we've got coming up. And it's our goal is not only to provide a fun time for the kids, but also to share the gospel. So we have Bible characters that are going to be there telling their story and giving out candy. And it's going to be a wonderful time. And thank you for being a part of it. We still could use some help. And so if you can come and help us, come at about 3:30 and help us set up and get things going, that would be a great blessing. Or see me or one of our other staff and they'll help you. But I'm so glad that you're here today. We are in part two of the series that we began last week called Not of This World. That God calls us to look at life through different lenses. He calls us as believers to think different from the world. And if you missed last week, what we talked about was the Apostle Peter wrote the book of 1 Peter of what we're looking at over these weeks. And Peter was writing to a group of beleaguered and persecuted Christians. It was a very difficult time in the world. It was there in the first century. There was a wicked Roman emperor named Nero that was persecuting the church. He had blamed the burning of Rome on them, and many of the Christians were in hiding. Domitian came along after him and caused massive persecution of the church, and it became a very difficult time. And almost you would think that the church would have been pushed down and snuffed out. You would think that all because of that persecution, people go, I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to live that kind of life because it's too hard. But instead of pushing it out, it's kind of like pressing on a fire. You throw a log on the, you throw something on the fire and you try to get it to go out, but instead it just spreads. And the gospel went out and began to change people's lives because they saw the gospel in life. They saw these persecuted Christians, how they responded. How they live, their values, their ideas, that difficulties didn't destroy them. It didn't get them to back down. It actually emboldened them to trust in God. And so Peter's writing to these believers, and he's writing to give them hope in the midst of their difficulty. I don't know about you. Well, I do know about you. These last couple of years, or this year and a half with COVID, has been a tough year. It's been a year of questioning, a year of doubt, a year of separation, families losing loved ones and never being able to see them once they go in the hospital or not being able to have services or not being able to go across country or take trips. It's been a tough year. But what they were experiencing was way beyond just a shutdown and social distancing. It was literally hiding for their life, that people wanted to destroy them. And Peter had this idea that he uses again and again in his writing. And the idea is this, is that you You're not of this world when you trust in Christ. That you are just, you're just passing through. You're just a sojourner. That your heavenly home is in heaven. It's not here on earth. And so what you experience here is just temporary. Yes, it's important. And what we do here prepares us for there. And we need to be faithful here so we receive God's blessing there. But this world is not home, and you're to be different. Matter of fact, if you're a follower of Christ, you're called to be different. You're called to stand out, not blend in. You're called to be separate than what others do. You have different values, different passions, a different way you use your time, a different way you parent, a different way you use your resources, a different way you have a relationship with your spouse. God says that as a believer, you're to be different. The King James uses a kind of a unique word. It says peculiar. And I've met a lot of peculiar people in my life. And God says when it comes to Christ, that's okay. Because God says you are going to be considered different. You're going to be considered out of touch when you trust in me, because people that don't want me will do all they can to persecute those who follow me. So turn in your Bible to 1 Peter chapter 1. 1 Peter chapter 1, and I'd like you to stand with me in honor of God's word and follow along. 1 Peter chapter 1, starting in verse 13, and these are powerful, powerful words today. Listen to this. Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope, there's that word hope, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires that you had when you lived in ignorance. Did you hear that? Don't conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance, but just as he who has called you is holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, God says, be holy because I am holy. Since you call on a Father who judges each person's work impartially, live your time as foreigners here in reverent fear. In other words, this world is not your own. You are not of this world. Pray with me, would you? Father, today in these few minutes we have together, we ask that you would do what I don't have the power to do, and each of us don't have the power to do, but you have, that you would personalize this message for our hearts. That God, that for those that are far from you, that I pray that your spirit would draw them close. For those who know you, that you would open up our hearts to you to show us the areas in our life that may be displeasing to you, that we've blended in instead of standing out. Help us to be set apart in all that we do, and we love you faithfully. Help us to please you honorably and be a light in a dark world. Help us to be different for your glory in all that we do. And we pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ. And we all said, amen. You may be seated. You know, the problem for so many people today, the problem that we have, if I can say, and problem for you, problem for me, is our biggest obstacle. Our biggest obstacle to fully following Jesus is our desire to fit in. It's our desire to be acceptable. It's our desire to look like we're like everybody else. And the biggest obstacle for so many is that we're trying to be faithful to God. He wants us to be different, but we're not so different. We just kind of do what everybody else does. We kind of look like everybody else. We kind of act like everybody else. And God goes, that's not who I've called you to be. I've called you to be an original, not a copy. I've called you to stand out, not just blend in. And so that's what he's trying to say to us. God didn't call you to fit in. He calls you to stand out. He never said to you that you're to do the things that everybody else is doing. He says, don't conform to the patterns of this world. Don't conform to the way they think. Don't conform to the way they do, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You see, it's what you think is ultimately what you do. And so what you put in is ultimately what comes out. But we think, well, I just want to be normal. Why would anybody want to be normal? I mean, just think about that. What's normal today? Why would you want to be normal? What's normal? Normal is broke. Normal is in bondage. Normal is fear. Normal is divorce. Normal is tension. Normal is sleepless nights. Normal is anxiety. Normal is not liking your job. It's fighting depression. That's what normal is. I don't want to be on the normal road. Do you? I want off that ride. Jesus said there is a normal road. It's a broad road, and there's a lot of people on that road. But that road doesn't lead anywhere. But he also said there's a narrow road. There's a small pathway, and the sad part, and I can almost hear the pathos in Jesus' voice as he's saying this, is it's a narrow road, but there's just few on it. Listen to what he said. He says, "For wide is the gate, and broad is the road that leads to destruction, and many enter through it. But small is the gate and narrow the road that leads to life, and only a few find it." My prayer is that we would be those few. My prayer is that we would be those, that we would be those few, and that we would be reaching out to bring others along with us. That we would be those people that go, no, don't go down the big way. Let's go in this way, because this is what leads to life, not to destruction. You see, it's not a normal path that we travel. Peter's speaking to a group of persecuted Christians. And perhaps, I don't know what's going on in your heart and your life. I know that a lot of us are dealing with issues and there's challenges. But I just pray that somehow the Lord, through the Holy Spirit, would speak to you today about what it means to be set apart to Him. What it means to follow Him. Because God calls us not to just blend in. He calls us to be different. So let's look again at 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 14. Peter says this. He says, "As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance." In other words, there's a time in your life when you didn't know any better. There was a time you were doing stuff and you just did it because that was the way it was and it just kind of came natural and you didn't think anything different. But he says, now be careful. Don't go back to that way because you do know better now. You don't have to live in ignorance. He says, don't do the things that aren't wise. And you know, the truth is a lot of people do that. Maybe you. We do the things that we look at and we go, well, really, that's not the best thing. It's not the wisest thing. But you know, it's the easiest thing. It's the thing that others are getting me to do and trying to get me to follow on. But Peter goes on to say this. He says, but just as God called you as holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, be holy because I am holy. We're to be holy because He's holy. We're to do different things because He does different things. And I want you to notice something that it doesn't say. Now, this is so key. It doesn't say, be happy in all you do because I am happy and you're called to be happy. I mean, it doesn't say that. And do you see that? The Bible says something that so many people don't believe. They believe the opposite. They believe that God wants me to be happy. I mean, that's God's purpose, right? Is that I feel good, that my life goes well, that everything works out for me, and I'm just so happy to be a Christian. I'm just so happy that I'm trusting in God. But there's something different from being happy. There's having joy from knowing Jesus and trusting in Jesus even when things aren't going well. You know, our struggle in Western Christianity and probably in other places around the world is that we believe that God's highest calling for us is to be happy. But the problem with happy is based on happenings. And we think all the happenings ought to be good and make us happy when a lot of happenings are not happy. They're actually sad. And then we wonder, well, where is God? How come God isn't taking care of me? But I want you to understand this, is that God's highest calling for you and for me is not our happiness. God's highest calling is our holiness. I want you to think of that again. God's highest calling for Jesus followers is not our happiness. God's highest calling for you and me is our holiness. That we would be set apart, that we would be different. And the problem is we have this false belief. It's really a theology of happiness. God wants me happy above all else. That's kind of how we define it. That's my theology in this world for so many people. But the problem is it's a false theology because it empowers self-justification. It empowers me to decide what I want instead of having God decide what he wants. It empowers me to justify my wrongdoing, though God says don't do it, but I can justify it because it makes me happy. And you think about it. Well, God wants me happy, so I ought to be able to do something. Otherwise, it's not wise or not prudent, or maybe it's wrong. I mean, if God wants me happy and I'm not happy in my marriage, and God wants me happy, but my spouse doesn't make me happy, then I deserve to look for happiness outside that marriage, right? I mean, I deserve that, to be happy. And so I can walk out the door, even though I've been in a covenant relationship, when I said, to death do us part, and everything's going to be fine because it's about my happiness. Or if I'm not happy with not having this thing, then I can beg and borrow and lie and steal, and I can take it, I can connive, I can do everything I can to get this thing because this thing is going to make me happy. Yeah, I don't, whatever it is, I'm going to get it because I've just got to have it because that's what will make me happy. Or if I'm dating somebody and I'm just saying, I know we love each other and we're going to get married someday, but God says don't have sexual relationships outside of marriage, but you know, I have needs. And I need to meet those needs, and it makes me happy to. And we justify what God says is not right, and all of a sudden we've blended in so much that God can't tell us apart from the world. And he says, depart from me, for I know you not. And so many people, we just justify what we do because that's what we want to do. And so if we want to do it, it must be right. Because we believe that God wants us to be happy above all else. But then all of a sudden, discomfort comes, delay comes, discouragement comes, risk comes, inconvenience comes, and conflict comes, and then we're mad at God because God didn't do what we want him to do and lead us the way he wanted us to go. And all of a sudden, without knowing it, we begin to worship this false god of comfort, of money, of pleasure, of things. Because God is supposed to get me what I want, right? God's supposed to do what I want him to do, and God is supposed to lead me where I want to go, and I was supposed to have that job, and I was supposed to have that thing, and I was supposed to have that spouse, and I was supposed to have that house, and I deserve this. But we need to understand that God does not exist to serve us. We exist to serve him. Ouch. Pastor, you're not making me very happy. This is uncomfortable. This is challenging. He calls us to be holy. What does holy mean? Holy literally means to be different. It's the word hagios in the scripture, and it means to be set apart to God. It means to be separated out. It means to be set apart. It means to be different. And so God says, do not conform to the patterns of this world, that he calls us to be set apart for his purpose to be different. And so let me tell you this, that if you're different from the world, there's a good chance that you may be following Jesus. But if you're not any different, there's a really good chance that you're probably not following Jesus. If you blend in so much that they can't tell you apart, well, I didn't know you were a Christian. I had no idea you went to church. All of a sudden, you have to question, well, am I really? God calls us to be different. He calls us to be set apart, to be holy. How do we do that? We don't do it in our own strength. We don't do it by our own abilities. We don't just say, well, I'm going to one day wake up and that's what I'm going to do. No, we do it because God's Holy Spirit works in us and cleanses us and transforms us. Don't conform any longer to the patterns of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Well, how does your mind get renewed? By the Holy Spirit working in you and cleansing that. The key is this. Follow Christ and have the courage to be different from this world. And who gives you that courage is the Spirit at work in you. It's standards, it's principles. When I teach first class and I offer first class, and I invite all of those of you who haven't gone through it, or maybe you've gone through it and want to go through it again, it's just talking about our vision, our values, our beliefs as a church. And I do it during Grow Group each Sunday. And it's just a short class, but I use it for our membership. And membership is a way that we show that we have a common confession and creed and a community together. But in that first class, we talk about different things that the scripture says that we're supposed to do and not supposed to do. And it's not about legalism. And you know, I've discovered something. Holiness always looks like legalism to somebody that doesn't know Jesus. It always does. Well, I'm sorry, I've chosen because of my faith not to drink. Well, I can't believe you. I mean, everybody drinks. Everybody takes, you know, everybody has a beer, has a wine. I mean, what do you think you're better than me? No. I don't do that. I just know me. I mean, I can't just eat one piece of chocolate. I just can't eat one Lay's potato chip. I can imagine that. I can't probably take one drink. The church has given me guidelines, not to say you can't drink. It's saying that don't get drunk, but it said be careful that you don't allow anything in your life to take you away from where God wants you to be. And that's just one simple area. Another one is just entertainment. What we watch, the kind of shows and the programs that we allow to feed our mind. Because you remember, garbage in, garbage out. Good stuff in, good stuff out. And so many times we'll spend hours watching a television program. And we'll say, it doesn't do anything to me. It's just fun entertainment. But it changes the way we think. It changes the way we see people. I can share a lot of opinions there, and I'm not going to do it. But, you know, there's some wisdom to look at what's on the television show and just ask the simple question, does this help me live a holy life? Or does it lead me down a different path? Is this going to help me become the person God wants me to be and share his love with other people? Or actually, is it going to desensitize me to other people? And make me where I could really care less about the needs of other people. You see, God's calling us to be holy in all we do. And parents, if you want to raise different kids, at some point your life has to be different. If you want your kids to be different from the world, if you want them to have the resolve and the resilience to stand up to pressure, then you got to give them that example. You got to show them that it's okay to be different, because there is such peer pressure in the world. There's so much peer pressure to go and do things that people don't want to do it, but because others are doing it, they do it. You see, the way we are holy may be little in my, it may be just a little bit different in my family than your family, but we've set certain standards, but God has a standard of holiness, and he lays it out in his word, and he challenges us that we would seek God for the standards that we believe would be pleasing to him. And there was a time, I grew up in the church, and the big thing when I was a kid was we don't go to movies. And we had a little statement, you know, we don't go to movies, we don't chew, and we don't go with girls that do. You know, you probably heard that. And so we were pretty proud that we didn't do that. And then all of a sudden, you know, we were asking the question, well, what's the problem with Lady and the Tramp? You know, what's the problem with the Wizard of Oz? And all of a sudden, we realized that, I think the church realized that we had created this legalistic standard without establishing the background, the why behind what we were doing. And so the church has come back and said, you know, movies are not the issue, because you can watch worse stuff on your television than you could ever see in a theater. I mean, you can, all day long, you can pick up your phone and watch worse things that you can find anywhere else. It's terrible. And so it's not saying, don't go there and don't do this. It's saying, guard my heart and guard my eyes and guard my mind. And so I've got to put certain standards and certain boundaries in place, because otherwise it will lead me away from God. And I love what the New Living Translation, how it translates verse 14. It says this, so you must live as God's obedient children. And he says this, listen to this, don't slip back. Don't slip back into your old ways to satisfy your old desires. Don't slip back. Don't fall into trouble, is what he's saying. How many of you know that it's easier to fall into trouble than it is to fall into righteousness. You can slip into trouble, but it's hard to slip. And I've never heard anybody say, I just couldn't help but be holy. I just couldn't help but do the right thing. I just couldn't help but be righteous. No, I hear them say, I just couldn't help but I sinned. I couldn't help that I disobeyed God. I couldn't help that I did that and I shouldn't have done. Nobody says, I just couldn't help it to be righteous. And he says, be careful. Don't slip back into your old ways. It doesn't happen that way because we have an enemy that seeks to steal, kill, and destroy, and he wants to rob us of everything that God wants for us. It's like he puts a syringe in us and he just sucks the life out of us. And so what we have to do is we have to keep being filled with the Spirit. We have to keep being filled with the presence of God and the Word of God, that when the enemy attacks, we've got so much overflowing with God that it's not diminishing us. It's actually infecting him. And it's changing what he's doing. We need to understand that Satan's mission is to steal, kill, and destroy relationships, churches, families. You know, and he comes to us subtle. He doesn't come to us and says, hey, I want you to be a devil worshiper. I mean, he never does that. I want you to sacrifice your animals to me in the garage. He doesn't do that. I mean, he comes to us subtly. And you know what he does? He does the same thing that he did back in the Garden of Eden. You know what he said? He said, did God really say, don't eat the fruit of that tree? Did God really say that you can't do that? I mean, and he comes to us and he's the greatest deceiver. And he raises doubts and he raises questions. And he says, did God say, and then you can fill in the blank on that. That he sows these doubts of fear and confusion and discouragement. And he leads us away from following the Spirit. Did God really say you're supposed to wait till marriage? Did God really say that I shouldn't listen to music with bad lyrics? Did God really say I shouldn't look at pornography? Did God really say that I shouldn't send pictures of myself to other people that really I can't show my parents? Did God really say that? You see, what makes this message so challenging is Satan comes and he gives us doubt and confusion. Because we're free. We can do whatever we want to do, right? Because God wants us happy. But the scripture comes back and says, oh, you've missed the whole point. It's not saying, well, I'm better than a lot of people. You see, a lot of people are not the standard. Well, mom and dad, everybody's doing it. Well, that's okay, but everybody's not the standard. God is the standard. His holiness is the standard. And you say, well, why does this even matter? Look again at 1 Peter, starting in verse 18. Peter says this to these hurting Christians, and he says, remember this. He says, for you know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver and gold, that you were redeemed from this empty way of life, handed down from your ancestors. He's saying, you know, we have sins of the Father from third and fourth and maybe 100 generations, that a lot of things that we are faced with is because our parents and our grandparents and others were faced with it, and Adam and Eve passed it down to us. And he says, you know, it's not with these perishable things, even the material things, the silver and the gold, that we are redeemed. He says, but he goes on, he says, but we're redeemed with the precious blood of Christ, the Lamb, without blemish or defect. You see, we kind of miss this point that Jesus, because he had no sin, could take our place who were full of sin, to set us free. And Jesus points us towards life. It's the risen Son of God that forgives us of our sins and makes us new. And he says this, he was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last days for your sake. Oh, praise the Lord, we live on this side of the cross. I can't imagine living on that side of the cross and the faith that it took and just the focus it took to follow God when there wasn't the Holy Spirit and it wasn't the Word of God. But we have all of that today. And we are redeemed because he says he was chosen before the creation of the world but was revealed in these last days for your sake. And look at this. Through him, you believe in God. Through Christ. who raised him from the dead and glorified him, so your faith and hope are in God. You see, living holy, just doing the right thing, just having standards is not the way to know God. It's not the way to know Christ. Knowing Christ is the way to living holy. And what a simple little illustration. We pulled out a mirror. What do you see? Well, I see me. But if you look in your heart and Jesus lives there and you pull it out and you look at it, what do you see? Jesus. And when we trust and we follow Jesus, our lives ought to reflect him more and more because he is at work in us and through us. And what I'm talking about here is not just behavior modification. It's not just saying, well, you got to do this and you got to do this and I've got to have these disciplines. What I'm talking about is an inward transformation of the Spirit. Because so many times we think, well, I have to make myself do this, and if I can just work this up. And what God does is he comes in by the Holy Spirit and changes our want to. That I want to know him. And you know what I've discovered? The more I read the Bible, the more I want to read it. The more I spend time in prayer, the more I want to spend time in prayer. But the less I spend time in prayer, the less I want to spend time in prayer. The less I read my Bible, the less I want to read my Bible. But I've learned that it's when I step close to God, when I draw near to him, like we talked about last week, he draws near to me and he helps me grow and live that holy life, because true holiness is an inside job. It's not about me cleaning up. It's about him cleaning me out. It's about him transforming me, not just me following a bunch of rules. It's not saying the rules are not important. It's not saying that I probably will live those rules once he works in me, but I'll live them not by my strength and my power. I'll live them by his Spirit living in me and through me. That I'm not trying to do this on my own. Let me ask you a question. What is it that you're struggling with in order to fit in? What area in your life is that you're going, I just want to be happy, and because of that, I'm actually compromising what's wise and what God wants? Have you ever put your happiness above God's call? You probably have. I have. We do. But what's the biggest way that God wants to work in your life? Or maybe it's just one way. That God wants you to be different. And that difference is to say, number one, it's not God, make me this way, but God, work in me that you can be who you are in me and through me. And that's why I love the fruit of the Spirit. The fruit of the Spirit is his fruit, not our fruit. It's him living inside of me, and all of a sudden I become love and I become joy and peace and not because of what I work up, it's what he does in me. And I do it beyond what I can even imagine, but he does it in me. My prayer is this, is that the Holy Spirit would show you an area of your life where he wants you to be different. That he wants you to trust in him. Not out of obligation to try harder, but out of a spiritual transformation. Because Jesus is the only one that can redeem us. It's his holiness is what we long for. Here's the truth. We're all sinners. We've all fallen short of the glory of God. We've all sinned and fallen away from God, but God was so good that he sent Jesus Christ to die for you and die for me. That by believing in his death, by believing in his love, that we can be forgiven of our sins, that we can be redeemed, that he was raised from the dead for us, for you and for me, that he sends his Holy Spirit, that we wouldn't just say, well, God, you're on the outside, but God comes and lives on the inside. And all of a sudden, I am redeemed because he is redeeming me. I love what John says. If we confess our sins, he's faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to purify us from all unrighteousness, to cleanse us, to live within us. Our prayer team is going to come. And they're going to come here to pray with you and to meet with you. And if you have a burden upon your heart today, if you have something you want to just say, you know, God's calling me to be different in this area and I need somebody to just agree with me in prayer. Or maybe I'm struggling with this sin or with this issue. Or maybe I'm praying for someone that has a need. Or maybe there's just something in my life that I need God's help in. They're here to pray with you. For others, you may just want to come and kneel at an altar and pray prayer and just say, God, here I am. I surrender to you. Because it's not about what I can accomplish and what I can do, and it's not about what I want, it's about what you want. So God, help me to get over myself. Help me to get over my desire to be happy. And work in me a desire and a yearning to be holy, because you live in me. Let's sing this song together, and then we're going to pray together. Come. The altar's open at this time. Our prayer leaders are here. Father, we thank you for your word today that calls us to be different, to be holy because you are holy. Lord, help us to recognize where we need your help, not just for an outward behavior modification, but for inside spiritual transformation. Lord, help us to get closer to you, to trust in you and your power and by your Spirit to change us, to renew our minds, to make us different from the inside out. Help us to fall in love with you more and more, that we cannot stay the same. Lord, you have the power to break addictions. You have the power to change mindsets. You have the power to cast down strongholds and to release us from bondage. And we pray, Father, right now, by your grace and by faith, that you would do those things. Work in us and through us. To you be the glory, for it's your holiness is what we long for. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Let's give God a hand this morning and say thank you for a God who loves us, who does these amazing things, who gives us the opportunity to enter into this holy relationship with him, to be known and to know him in a greater way. This morning we have a special presentation, so Melissa, if you'll come at this time.
Good morning. Most of you know that October is the traditional pastor appreciation month, although we need to be appreciating and praying for them all year long. We have some special boxes, so if our pastors and spouses could make their way up to the front, we'd like to give you your gift. And we'd like to thank you for being, for serving the Lord and being our pastors. And we appreciate your families as well, because it's kind of an all-in type of job to join in the ministry and to deal with us. Let's pray. Oh, our Father, we just thank you for our pastors and our staff and the way that they lead us. And I just pray a special anointing on their lives. In your name we pray. Amen.
Well, as a staff, we just want to say thank you. We appreciate you guys and the opportunity to serve you on a daily basis. It's not just the Sundays and the Wednesdays and the times we have events, but it's every opportunity we get to interact with you. It's a joy. We love you. And again, without people, there is no ministry. Without relationships, there is nothing. And so outside of God, you are our everything, and we say thank you because you guys are loved, and we enjoy each time we get to say thank you and to serve alongside you. And one of those opportunities is tonight with Trunk or Treat. We are so excited to minister to our community, to step out, to walk alongside people just as they're having some fun. And so if you haven't volunteered, there's a place to sign up there in the atrium, but also, as Pastor mentioned, be here at 3:30 this afternoon, help set up, but also just invite people. There's cards right there in the middle of the atrium. We want to encourage you to make people a priority, because they can't know Jesus unless they're in relationship with people who do. And so step out, find those opportunities to touch somebody's life, to feed into them a little bit. One of those ways that we also serve and honor God is through our giving. And so we have a kiosk in the back and also on our church app. Why? Because we recognize everything that we are given is a gift from God. And our returning of that tithe, that offering, is a way to say thank you. And so this morning, as we grab a cup of coffee, as we just fellowship together, knowing that God has been so good to us, as we go into our grow groups to learn, to grow some more, we're reminded that our mission is one thing, and that's to connect people to a vibrant life in Jesus Christ.